Your Highness, Sheikh Hamza bin Nasser, Your Excellency, Sheikh Hind bin Hamad Thani, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, HBKU management, and especially the class of 2016. Mabruk. Today, I want to tell you about something I call the power of Yalla. Yalla, a very powerful word. But first, let me tell you about something else. Let me tell you first how proud I am to be here with you today, particularly because, well, I was not the perfect student. I was a troublemaker at school. You can say that my professors, my teachers, used to prefer me outside of the class than inside of it. And even when I was inside of the class, they used to keep this island of empty seats around me, as if I was contagious or something. I hear some laughter. Someone in the room is also a troublemaker. Today, I realize, however, that this troublemaking is nothing else but the seed of my entrepreneurial journey. My foray into the startup world was at the age of 13. I was in school at the time. I grew up in Beirut, a bit close to Beirut, and my neighborhood friends and I used to love movies. And we knew our way around computers, so we decided to make and sell bootleg videos. We set up shop at my friend's house, Samir. We used his bedroom as the production lab. His bed was a storage facility. We had a great distribution system into the schools, a great pricing strategy, and the students were our target market. Even when students did not have cash, we took different things like sports magazines, video games, and more movies. It was great. I made so much money that a 13-year-old would ever imagine. I went and told my uncle. He was a young uncle, you know, friendly and all of that. And he went and told my mom. And my mom came and shut the company down. So we had to liquidate, besides getting grounded for a few months. So with this first failure comes the first lesson of Yalla. The power of Yalla is about challenging the system. It is about challenging the rules, but it is not about being unethical. So above all, stay ethical. After I finished AUB in 2002 as a computer engineer, I went to California with a dream to work in the movie industry again. So, but little did I know that it was impossible for an Arab to get a job in Hollywood after 9/11. Meanwhile, I had a friend who was at MIT, and so I used her username and password to often go on the discussion board and check what's happening there. One day, I find an amazing group of researchers working on this cutting-edge computer graphics technology that would revolutionize how movies and games are created. With my obsession in movies, I took that same flight that week to Boston, met with them, and very quickly became the founding member of our new startup. We grew the company to dozens of employees, raised millions of dollars, and opened offices all across the country. But we did it all wrong. In fact, we obsessed about building the technology. We tried to perfect the product that we forgot how to check with the client. We forgot to check what the customer wanted. And so I remember one day I came to the office and the investor had taken over. They fired everyone. It was devastating. With the second failure, yes, there's a pattern here. The second failure comes the second lesson. The power of Yalla is all about being scrappy and fast. Forget the master plan. Dump the master plan in the trash. You can have the best technology in the world, but if no one uses it, what's the point? So move fast and iterate and do not overplan. Then came 2006, and with it came the war of Israel and Lebanon. I was still in Boston. And it was the first time during my life where I was not in Lebanon during a war. It felt horrible. I was so frustrated and anxious. I wanted to do something about it. The country was in ruin. So I thought maybe I can do a fundraising campaign to bring millions of dollars to support relief efforts on the ground in Lebanon. But who am I? I'm this 26-year-old geek. Who would believe in me? Who would give me that amount of money? I had to have backing behind me. I had to have a credible brand behind me. So I picked up the phone and called International Red Cross in Geneva. I told them, I'm going to bring you hundreds of mosques and churches and communities to donate money to you. To my surprise, they accepted. I must have sounded pretty convincing. So now I had the Red Cross behind me. I had to execute. What do I do? I went online. It was before the social media days. I went online and on chat rooms connected to two people that are like-minded, one in Minnesota and one in Seattle. And together we launched Relief Lebanon, a movement to help the fundraising efforts in North America. In less than 2 months, we did hundreds of fundraising campaigns and raised $2 million in the individual donations. Even one time, the United Nations gave us an award, but the movement was anonymous, so we even discovered it later on. Perhaps with this experience comes the strongest trait of Yalla. If you see something you care about that's broken, take action. Don't just say something, act. Don't ask for permission. Don't be afraid to fail, just act. During that same 2006 war, as I was in Boston, my parents were in Lebanon. I was anxious. I wanted to call them all the time, but phones were not reliable. So I had to go and get my news online, obviously in Arabic on the web. I didn't have an Arabic keyboard. How do I search for this news? Same time, I was talking to my friends, I was chatting, using Arabic words, but you know, using the sevens and the threes, but those are Arabic words. So it hit me. Why not come up with a technology that allows those words to transform into real Arabic? And this is where the idea of Yamli, the typing and search technology, came about. Now, I wanted to find the best technical co-founder I can find. I wanted to find the smartest person. The smartest person I used to know at that time was Hamad Jaidini, the only non-Arab in my previous startup. He didn't speak Arabic, though. But at the time, Hamad had his own startup. So I wanted to convince him to stop his startup and work with me. It was very hard. I remember I used to know his gym, the gym he used to go to. So for 1 month, I tracked him down. He used to go to the elliptical. I hate the elliptical. I took the elliptical next to him for a month, trying to convince him to join me, until I convinced him. Now we had a team. We had to start. And I had to go back to the same Arabic books I used to avoid as a kid, only to discover the complexity and beauty of the Arabic language. In a few months, we launched Yamli. We got millions of users, tons of press, tons of awards. But we had a problem. In fact, we had a big problem. We couldn't monetize it. We had raised money from investors, but we weren't making enough money to keep on going. We tried an advertising model, but at that time in 06, the Arab advertiser wouldn't spend money online. So I just did what I had to do. I sold all of my furnitures and kept only my bed. I remember one night vividly, I went online to check my bank account, only to find that I had a few hundred dollars left. My credit cards were in the red. While the outside world was touting us and giving us awards and making us as Arab innovators, I was in my room, broke and terrified. That same night, I decided this cannot be it. There must be a way. There has to be a way. So I spent my night all just looking for companies around us in Boston and in the US that could use a technology like ours in the linguistic space, maybe something I didn't think about. I sent so many emails that night, and I went to bed at maybe 4 or 5 a.m. The next morning, maybe the afternoon, after I woke up, to my surprise, I get an email back. There's a company working in linguistics that wants to use our technology, has been looking at it for years, but wants to use it in a different way that they didn't think about. In a couple of weeks, we had a business deal, our bank accounts replenished, and a new business model to think about. Success. A year later, we did a deal with Yahoo, and today we empower all of Arabic tools on Yahoo. Today, Yamli has empowered millions of users to type approximately about 10 billion words, which is the equivalent of 120,000 Arabic books. This ride was a roller coaster, but it taught me a lot. And so, here's the fourth power of Yalla lesson. Do not get fooled by awards and press coverage. Stay focused on the goal, but be ready to adapt. Maintain persistent flexibility. As I was building Yamli, I was splitting my time between Boston and the Middle East. And I built a lot of very strong friendships with Arab entrepreneurs. I was so impressed with their amazing energy and resilience. But I noticed one big difference. The support they were getting from the ecosystem was much more minimal than the one I was getting back in Boston and felt unfair. So in 2011, and after we did our deal with Yahoo, I decided to move back to the Middle East. And with my mentor, Fadi Ghandour, we started Wamda, a platform to support and invest in entrepreneurship in the Middle East. Over the past 5 years, we supported thousands of entrepreneurs, covering their stories, mentoring them, and investing in their startups. In a region where youth unemployment is one of the highest, entrepreneurship is not only a job creator, it's a tool for optimism and positive change. These entrepreneurs, those Arab entrepreneurs, these are the ones that are our role models. Not the Bill Gates, not the Steve Jobs, but these regional entrepreneurs. I'm talking about Hind Habaya, who is a graduate of Qatar Foundation Startup Science, an amazing program, and the founder of a company called Instabeat, a wearable that you put on your goggles as you swim and give you performance. Hind is an amazing role model, an amazing woman engineer that took her final project and made it into a company. I'm talking about Mohanad Ghashim, who fled Aleppo under the war to build what today is the largest e-commerce platform in the region. I'm talking about Jihad Kawas, 17-year-old dropout who today is building a company in Silicon Valley to compete with eBay. I'm talking about Alaa Salal, who emerged from the outskirts of Amman in a very underserved areas, initially because he and his brothers decided to take the book of Harry Potter and put it into Arabic online. Got millions of downloads, but got sued by the publishers. Anyone else would have given up. Alaa said, you know what, this actually is an opportunity. I see people want to read Arabic books. So he started Jamalon, which today is the largest online bookstore. Those entrepreneurs are the true embodiment of the power of Yalla. And the final lesson is the following. We all have an amazing energy within us. We are not born with entrepreneurship skill sets. We nurture them. We all have the power of Yalla, and if you harness it well, we can do a huge impact. As you embark on your new journey, you're faced with a tough and highly unpredictable environment. The future is not fixed. It is there to be imagined and created. You don't need to be an entrepreneur to be part of this future, but you do need the entrepreneurship skill sets. As graduates of HBKU, you are publicly accepting today a responsibility towards Qatar and the region's futures. Hang your degrees on your walls if you want, but do not cherish them. Cherish the moments, cherish the connections. Truth is, degrees do not define you. What you do with them does. Never stop learning, and never get comfortable, ever. Comfort zones are the black holes of evolution. The moment you realize that you can rearrange all what is around you, that you can challenge the conventional wisdom and improve things, you can no longer be an observer of life. So, my friends, do not wait for change to happen. Do not ask for change to happen. Create change. Imagine a better future and create it. This is the power of Yalla. Go out there and create change. Thank you.